Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Blood Lure by Nevada Barr, narrated by Barbara Rosenblat. This work is copyrighted 2001 by Nevada Barr. This recording is copyrighted 2001 by Recorded Books. The Blood Lure. It's a revolting amalgam of fish guts and cow's blood, left to rot and ripen for more than 2 months until it stinks to high heaven. Downright repulsive to human beings. Absolutely irresistible to grizzly bears. And now, Blood Lure.
Chapter 1. With the exception of a 9-week-old Australian shepherd puppy, sniffing and whining as if he'd discovered a treasure chest and sought a way inside, everyone was politely pretending Anna didn't stink. Under the tutelage of Joan Rand, the biologist overseeing Glacier's groundbreaking bear DNA project, Anna had spent the morning in an activity so vile, even garbage men had given her wide berth, holding their noses in awe. Near Glacier National Park's sewage processing plant, behind an 8-foot chain-link fence sporting 2 electrified wires, and further protected in an aluminum shed the size of an old 2-holer outhouse wrapped in 6 more strands of electrical fencing, lay the delights the excited black-and-white pup whiffed. 2 50-gallon drums, filled with equal parts cow's blood and fish flotsam, heated and left to steep for 2.5 months in what was referred to as the brew shed. Joan, apparently born without a gag reflex, had cheerfully taught Anna how to strain fish bits out with one hand while ladling red-black liquid into 1-liter plastic bottles with the other. "Fingers work best," Rand had said. "Pure research. The glamour never stops." With that, she had flashed Anna small, crooked, very white teeth in a grin that, in other circumstances, might have been contagious. Standing now in the offices of the science lab, the puppy beginning to lick her bootlaces, Anna was glad she'd not succumbed to the temptation to smile back. Had she done so, her teeth would probably be permeated with a god-awful stench that could only be described as eau de carrion, the quintessential odor of death on a bender, the devil's vomit. "It wears off." A kindly woman with shoulder-length brown hair looked up from a computer console as if Anna's thoughts had been broadcast along with her smell. "It just takes a while. Have you worked with the skunk lures yet?" "That's for dessert," Anna replied grimly, and the woman laughed. "That's the lure of choice. Joan says they roll and play in it like overgrown dogs. That lure is so stinky, you've got to pack it in glass jars. Goes right through plastic." Anna thought about the blood lure, the skunk. Both had been painstakingly researched, other scents tried and discarded, till those most irresistible to grizzly bears had been found. And she was going to be carrying these scents on her back into the heart of bear country in Montana's side of the Waterton Glacier International Peace Park. Nothing between her and the largest omnivores in the lower 48 but a can of pepper spray. The puppy woofed and put portentously large paws on her shins, his black-fringed tail describing short, fat arcs. "You want to roll in me, don't you?" Anna asked. He barked again, and she quashed an urge to pick him up, defile his soft new fur with her tainted hands. Turning away from the importuning brown eyes, she studied the color photocopies of Ursus Horribilis, thumbtacked to a long bulletin board situated over a conference table. The muscular hump between the shoulders developed, it was thought, to aid in the main function of the 4-inch claws, digging. Fur was brown, tipped or grizzled with silver, earning the bear its name. Ears were rounded, plump teddy bear ears. Teeth less sanguine, the canines 1 inch or so in length, well suited to their feeding habits. Grizzly bears ate carrion, plants, ground squirrels, insects, and sometimes people. Anna thought about that. Thought about the olfactory enticements she would carry, handle, sleep beside at night. Stepping closer, she studied the pictures of massive heads, long jaws, paws that could topple a strong man, claws that could disembowel with ease, and she felt no fear. Members of the bear team, who monitored bear activities in the park and settled bear-visitor disputes, and the glacier rangers routinely lamented the fact that the American people were such idiots, they thought of these wildest of animals as big, cuddly pets. One man had been stopped in the act of smearing ice cream on his 5-year-old son's cheek in hopes of photographing a bear licking it off. Anna was too well-versed in the critter sciences to believe the animals harmless. She fell into a second and equally dangerous subspecies of idiot, those who felt a spiritual connection with the wild beasts, be they winged, furred, or toothed. A sense that they would recognize in her a kindred spirit and do her no harm nullified a necessary and healthful terror of being torn apart and devoured. This delusion didn't extend to the lions of Africa. One couldn't expect them not to eat an overseas tourist. Everybody enjoys an exotic dish now and again. But American lions, American bears. She laughed aloud at herself. Fortunately, she wasn't fool enough to put interspecies camaraderie to the test, and never would she admit any of this to anyone. Least of all, Joan Rand, her keeper, trainer, and companion for the 19 days that she was cross-training on the Greater Glacier Bear DNA Project, gleaning knowledge that could be put to use to better manage wildlife in her home park, the Natchez Trace Parkway in Mississippi. "Ah, my stinky little friend, your vacation package is ready," Joan said as she emerged from an inner sanctum. Rand was American by birth, French-Canadian by proximity, and she sounded precisely like Pepe Le Pew, the cartoon Parisian skunk, when she chose to. Anna laughed. Joan would remember Pepe. She was near Anna in years, somewhere in that fertile valley of middle age between 45 and 55. Anna had liked Joan right off. Rand was on the short side, 5'2" and stocky, with the narrow shoulders of a person who couldn't carry much weight and the solid butt and thighs of somebody who could hike a marine drill sergeant into the ground. Anna liked the quickness of her mind and the gravelly quality of her voice. She liked her humor. But in the 2 days they'd lived and worked together, she'd not felt an ease of companionship. It seemed she was always looking for something to say. Mostly, silences were filled with work. Those that weren't had yet to become comfortable, but Anna had hopes. The bear researcher dropped the skunk accent, adjusted her oversized glasses, and said, "Take a seat. This is Rory Van Slyke. He's our Earthwatch Sherpa, General Dog's Body, and has promised, should a bear attack, to offer up his firm young flesh so that you and I might live to continue our important work." Rory, the individual to whom Joan referred, smiled shyly. In her years with the National Park Service, Anna had only had occasion to cross paths with the Earthwatch organization once before. Some years back, when she was a boat patrol ranger on Isle Royale National Park in Lake Superior, Earthwatch, an independent environmental organization funded by donations and staffed by volunteers, had been working on a moose study with the National Park Service. They had the unenviable task of hiking cross-country through the ruggedest terrain of a rugged park, seeking out dead and rotting moose, counting the ticks on the carcasses, then packing out the really choice parts for further study. They did this not merely voluntarily, they paid for the privilege, suggesting that the altruism gene was not a myth. All of the Earthwatchers she'd met, including Rory Van Slyke, were young, probably because the work they did would kill a grown-up. "How you do?" Anna said mechanically. "Well, thank you. And yourself?" A long time had passed since anybody had bothered to finish the old-fashioned greeting formula. Evidently, Rory had been raised right, or strictly. "Fine," she managed. The boy, young man, had a light, high voice that sounded as if it had yet to change, though he was clearly years past puberty. He didn't look substantial enough to be much of a Sherpa, but as bear bait, he'd do just fine. Slight build, tender-looking skin, coarse sandy hair, and dark blue eyes fringed with lashes so pale as to be virtually invisible. "Here's the plan." Joan spread a topographical map on the table in front of Anna, then leaned over her shoulder to point. She, too, stank to high heaven. It was good to be a member of a group. "We've gridded the park into cells 8 kilometers on a side," Joan said, as she dropped a transparent plastic overlay on the topographical map, aligning it with coordinates she carried in her head. "Each cell is numbered. In every square, every cell, we've put a hair trap. This is not to trap the bear in toto, but merely designed to ensure visiting bears leave behind samples of their hair for the study. Traps are located near as we can make them on the natural travel routes of the bears. Mountain passes, the confluence of avalanche chutes, that sort of thing. So we're talking some serious off-trail hiking here, bushwhacking at its whackingest. These asterisks," she poked a blunt brown forefinger at marks made by felt marker on the overlay, "are where the last round of traps are located. They've been in place 2 weeks. The three of us will take 5 of the cells. Numbers 331, 23, 52, 53, and 64. Here on the central and west side of Flat Top Mountain. What we'll be doing is going into the old traps, collecting the hair, dismantling the traps, and setting them up in the new locations, here." She put another plastic overlay on top of the first, and a second set of asterisks appeared. "Or as close to these respective heres as we can get. Mapping locations out on paper, in the cozy confines of the office, has very little relationship to where you can actually put them when you get out into the rocky, cliffy, shrubby old backcountry. Once the trap wire is strung, we pour the elixir of the gods. That's this blood and fish guts perfume you are pretending not to notice on us, Rory, into our new trap, and leave for another couple of weeks. While wandering around up there, we'll also cover the Flat Top Mountain Trail from below 50 Mountain Camp to the middle of the Waterton Valley and the West Flat Top Mountain Trail from the Continental Divide to Dixon Glacier. Bears are like us. They like to take the easy way when they can. So we've located and marked a number of trees along the trail system that they are particularly fond of scratching their backs on. We'll collect hair samples from these, as well as any samples of scat we happen across." The lecture was for Rory. Anna had heard it before when Joan and her boss Kate explained the daunting task of data gathering for the DNA project. The inspiration of Kate Kendall, a researcher working jointly with the USGS, the United States Geographical Survey, and the NPS. From the hair and scat collected, the DNA of individual bears would be extracted. Modern techniques used by the lab at the University of Idaho would establish gender, species, and individual identification of the animals sampled. With this information, it was hoped an accurate census of the bears could be established, as well as population trends, travel routes, and patterns. This trapping system had been designed to give every single bear at Glacier an opportunity to be counted. "We'll be out 5 days," Joan finished, "leaving tomorrow at the crack of dawn." No one spoke for a moment, the three of them gazing at the map as if at any moment it would begin to divulge its secrets. "Hey," Joan said, breaking the silence, "maybe we'll see your folks, Rory." The young man woofed, a small expulsion of air through the nostrils that spoke volumes, none of them good, about how he viewed the proximity of his parents. Anna looked at him from the corner of her eye. Down was gone from his cheek, recently replaced by a beard so fair it glistened rather than shadowed at the end of the day. He was 17 or 18, I guess. Very possibly on his first great away-from-home adventure. and Mom and Dad found a way to horn in. Just to see if any of her surmises were in the ballpark, Anna said, "How so, your folks?" and prepared to listen with an expression that would pass for innocent with the unwary. "Mom and Dad are camping at 50 Mountain Camp for a week. Mom got this sudden urge to get back to nature." "Quite a coincidence," Anna needled, to see what kind of response she could scare up. "No sense smelling stinky if one couldn't be a stinker." "Mom's kind of..." Rory's voice trailed off. Anna didn't detect any malice, just annoyance. "Kind of into the family thing. Sort of happy campers altogether. She knows I won't see a lot of her, if at all. She can always amuse herself. And of course, Les has to come, if she came." Now there was malice. A pretty hefty dose of it for a lad so green in years. "Les?" Anna prodded, because it was in her nature to do so. "My dad. Carolyn's my stepmother." Had Anna, for some unfathomable reason, chosen to go forth and populate the earth with offspring of her own, it would have cut her to the heart to hear herself mentioned in the tones Rory used when speaking of his dad. The kinder notes poured out upon the step-parent would have been just so much salt in the wound. "I doubt we'll even see them from a distance," Joan said. "This itsy-bitsy chunk of map I've been pointing at represents a whole lot of territory when you're covering it on foot." There was a slamming the iron door quality to her dismissal of the domestic issue that made Anna suspect her of being a mother in her other life, if she had another life. In the 48 hours Anna had known her, Rand had worked like a woman buying off a blackmailer. It wasn't that she lacked humor or zest, but that she pushed herself as if her sense of security was held hostage and only hard work could buy it back. A classic workaholic. Anna's sister, Molly, had been one until she'd nearly died. Then, at the ripe age of 55, fallen in love for maybe the first time. Molly was a psychiatrist. She could tell Joan that no amount of work would suffice. But if Joan was a true workaholic, she wouldn't have time to listen. Personally, Anna loved workaholics, especially when they worked for her. In a sense, those laboring to save one square inch of wilderness, rescue one caddisfly larva from pollutants, were in the deepest sense public servants. And maybe, if the gods took pity and the public woke up, these rescuers would save the world, one species, one coral reef, one watershed at a time. Anna had organized a backpack so often it took her no more time than a veteran airline pilot packing for a 4-day trip. The 5 liters of blood and guts were secured in a hard plastic pelican case. Rory would carry that. Anna and Joan split the rest of the equipment between them. Fencing staples and hammers, vials of ethanol for scat samples, envelopes for hair, a trap log to record the salient facts of the site, like where precisely in the 2 million acres of glacier each 400-square-foot trap was located so the next round of researchers could find it. The skunk lures, 5 in all, weighed next to nothing. Wool, permeated with the scent purchased from a hunting catalog, was stuffed in film canisters and stowed in a glass jar. That went in Anna's pack. In under 2 hours, everything was arranged to Joan's satisfaction. The women spent the remainder of the evening at a scarred oak table in Joan's dining area going over BIMS, Bear Incident Management Systems reports. Joan lived in park housing, and Anna felt peculiarly at home. There was a sameness to the quarters that engendered a bizarre, dreamlike déjà vu. It wasn't merely the prevalence of the Mission 66 ranch-style floor plans. 3 bedrooms, L-shaped living area, and long, narrow kitchen circa 1966, the last time the NPS had gotten major funding for employee housing. It was the decor. Rangers, researchers, and naturalists from seasonal to superintendent could be counted on to have park posters on the walls, a kachina or two on the shelves, Navajo rugs over the industrial-strength carpeting, and an assortment of mismatched, unbreakable plastic dishes in the kitchen. The predictability of the surroundings had dulled Anna's natural curiosity. Remembering now her suspicion as to her hostess's family leanings, she took off the drugstore half-glasses she'd finally admitted to needing for close work and looked around the compact living area. On top of the television, between a Cocopelli doll standing on an ojo de Dios and the skull of some large canid, were framed school portraits of two boys, either fraternal twins or very close in age. Both were stunningly beautiful. A pedophile's dream come true. Thinking of the children in those terms brought Anna up short. Dark thoughts, dire predictions, a view of the world as a dangerous and dirty place was an occupational hazard for those in law enforcement. Even park rangers, whose days were spent in beautiful places, populated by largely benevolent, if occasionally misguided, vacationers. Her promotion to district ranger on the Natchez Trace Parkway was taking its toll. The trace was a road, hence Anna was a cop. Asphalt could be relied on to be a conduit for crime. The boys in the picture frames, not potential victims, but future promise made flesh. Attitude screwed around the right way, Anna asked, "Are those your sons?" "Luke and John," Joan said. "Good apostolic names," Anna smiled. "What happened to Matthew and Mark?" "Steelborn." Anna's brain skidded to a halt. A feeble jest had struck the jugular. "Shit," she said sincerely. "Yep." Silence settled around them, oddly comfortable this time, more so given this silence's root. "John graduates high school this year. Luke's a junior. I got pregnant while nursing. Another old wives' tale bites the dust. They live with their dad in Denver." There was no need for elaboration. The Park Service, though sublime in many respects, was hell on marriages. Anna was all too familiar with the forlorn photographs of shattered families. Accompanied by an alarming creaking noise that she hoped was the ladder-back chair and not Joan's sacroiliac, the researcher rose. She crossed to the television, returned with the pictures, and set them down amid the BIMS reports and scat sample tubes. "They're good-looking boys," Anna said, to make up for her evil, pedophilic thoughts. "Their dad was a virtual Adonis. Still is. Still knows it. Still drives the little girls wild." Another chapter in the same old story. "Ah," Anna said. "If I ever marry again, it'll be to a rich old hunchback with bad teeth." Picking up a frame, Anna studied the photos simply because she thought Joan had brought the pictures that they might be pored over and admired. "John? Luke. Though he's younger, he's the bigger boy." Around the eyes, brown and, because of a slight downturn at the outer corners, sad-looking, Luke resembled his mother. In all else, he had followed along the Adonis lines. "Looks a bit like Rory Van Slyke," Anna said. "Looks" wasn't quite the right word. The two boys did have a surface resemblance, but it was the eyes that made them so alike, a depth of vision that boys shouldn't have. As if, during what should have been carefree childhood years, they had seen enough of life to become weary. "I noticed that," Joan said. Wistfulness permeated the words. Joan missed her sons. Maybe picked the Van Slyke boy from the Earthwatch litter because he reminded her of Luke. Evidently, Joan heard her own vulnerability and was shamed by it. At any rate, the moment of intimacy was over. "Bims," she said overbrightly. "Never a dull moment. Let me read you one." The forms had been made up in an attempt to keep a record of every bear sighting in the park. They were filled out by visitors and park personnel alike to gather information on the activities and whereabouts of the grizzlies and their less alarming cousins, the black bears. Each form had places for writing the location of sighting, date, time, observer, color of bear, observer's activity, and, the most entertaining, if not always the most illuminating, the comments section, where the activities of the bear were described. Joan shuffled through her pile of bims, and Anna noted, in the process, managed to turn the photos of her sons so they faced away. Here it is. Listen to this. Big bear. Major Mondo hippo of a bear. 1,000 to 1,200 pounds. Too big? By half. In Glacier, grizzlies don't reach the size they do in Alaska, where they have access to all that salmon protein. Here, an average male weighs in at 350 or 400 pounds. The females, a little less. We get a lot of exaggerated reports. I can't say as I blame folks. When you see a bear and you're all alone in the big bad woods, they do have a tendency to double in size. Joan's jocularity was forced. Equilibrium was not yet reestablished. The ghosts of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John still hovered over the scat bottles. Anna wondered whether the situation with the boys was intense or if it was just Joan. I got a good one, she offered in the spirit of denial. She paged back till she located a form filled out in lavender ballpoint. August 5th, no location, no time, no observer name. Species, grizzly. Age, 26. Color, blonde. Don't know if this means the bear was 26 and blonde or the observer was. Blonde for our bears is rare. That's not the rare part, this is. Anna read aloud from the comments box. Bear activity, juggling what looked like a hedgehog. Observer activity, standing amazed. Joan laughed, and the air was clear again. Tales of visitor silliness could always be counted on to bring back a sense of normalcy to park life. Reports like that reassure me that Timothy Leary's alive and well and doing drugs with Elvis, the researcher said. After 10 o'clock, in Joan's spare room, furnished, as was every spare room in every Park Service house Anna had ever slept in, with peculiar oddments of furniture heavily representing the 1950s and Walmart, and a closet full of backpacks, coats, and sleeping bags good to 10 below zero, Anna lay awake. Her book, an old, well-read copy of The Wind Chill Factor, was open on her chest. Seeing the shapes of animals in the water stains on the ceiling, as she used to do as a child, she contemplated the upcoming backcountry trip. Months had passed since she'd done anything more strenuous than sit on her posterior in an air-conditioned patrol car. The most weight she'd lifted with any regularity was a citation book and government-issue pen. In desperation, she joined an aerobics class at the Baptist Healthplex in Clinton, Mississippi. But she'd only gone twice. One of the requirements for inclusion in this cross-training venture had been the ability to carry a 50-pound pack. Anna hadn't lied. She could carry 50 pounds. Just how far remained to be seen. She hoped she wouldn't slow everybody down. She hoped Joan wouldn't have Rory Van Slyke unwittingly bearing, along with the blood of sacrificial cows, the burden of stillborn apostles, because of an uncanny likeness to long-absent sons. She hoped she'd see some grizzly bear cubs, and that the cubs' mama wouldn't see her. Chapter 2. Because Joan Rand was a small woman with a great brain, their packs weighed closer to 40 than 50 pounds, a fact Anna knew she would be increasingly grateful for as the day wore on. The first 3 miles of the 12-mile hike were fairly straight and level. The second three ascended 2,500 feet in steep switchbacks. Rory's pack was somewhat heavier, as befitted the younger, stronger, taller, and more to the point, junior member of the team. 2,500 feet was the ascent Anna used to climb twice a week, from the ranger station in Guadalupe Mountains National Park to the high country. She'd been younger, stronger, and taller herself in those days, and still it was a bitch of a climb. A member of the bear team assigned to handle bears that clashed with visitors gave them a lift partway up the famous Going to the Sun Road, that cut through some of the most scenic country in the park. A road made in the 20s and 30s, when labor was cheap, and so was wilderness. He dropped them off at Packer's Roost, a horse and hiker staging area at the bottom of Flat Top Mountain. Unlike some of the parks Anne had worked, Glacier was a pristine rather than a rehabilitated wilderness. Most of the land had never been logged, mined, or grazed. The trees were old growth, the land scarred only by the natural phenomena of fire, flood, and avalanche. An unusual departure from this purity was the old fire road they followed to the beginning of the ascent. Because it had once been cut clear of trees, then left to heal, it had a fairy tale quality. A wide swath of delicate green moss grew in from the road's edges to a narrow trail kept barren by foot traffic. This living carpet was starred with tiny white star-shaped flowers. Overhead, feathery branches of fir and cedar closed out the sun. A tenuous, heady perfume, found only in the mountains of the West, scented the air. With each breath, Anna was transported. As she walked, she enjoyed flashbacks to the Southern Cascades at Lassen Volcanic and to the tip of the Rocky Mountains in Durango before they let go their alpine greenery and flowed into the red mesas of New Mexico. Those native to Montana had been complaining of an uncharacteristic heat wave that was pushing temperatures into the 80s. But Anna, having so recently fled a Mississippi August, reveled in the cool and the shade. Joan went first, followed by Rory. Anna took up the rear. Over the years, she'd found by slowing down and dropping back a little, she could slip free of the chatter zone and enjoy the solitude of the hike. And hear the silence. Nothing stirred. No birds fussed above or scratched in needles and leaves. Insects didn't buzz. Squirrels and chipmunks didn't clatter through the treetops, scolding her for trespassing. She wondered if the western forests had always been so preternaturally quiet, or if her ears had merely become accustomed to the ongoing concert of life that played in the woodlands of the deep south. Or perhaps there was a great toothy predator that had momentarily struck dumb the lesser beasts of the forest. Anna waited for a titillating frisson of fear to follow the thought, but it didn't. Fire ants, now they put the fear of God into her, not grizzlies. Rory, she could tell, was not so sanguine. On the ride up, the bear team guy had regaled them with the story of an attack he'd worked on two summers before. Three hikers had been mauled in the Middle Fork area, the southern edge of the park. Joan, kindly disposed to the damaged hikers, but clearly protective of the accused bear, had given her take on the events. Once or twice a year, a bear mauled a visitor. Usually the person was not killed. Grizzlies, Joan told them, did not customarily attack with the idea of eating one. Grizzlies kept their cubs with them 2 or even 3 years. With the exception of humans and the great apes, they were the animals who spent the most time educating their young. They taught them how to survive, where to find springs in dry years, what plants to eat, and where they grew. A female grizzly didn't bear offspring until she was 6 and would only have 5 to 10 cubs in her lifetime. This made her extremely protective of them. When she perceived a threat, whether another bear or a hiker, her goal was not to eat it, but to teach it the meaning of fear. Seldom would she charge a group of 4 or more people. The threat to her and hers was perceived as too great to overcome, and she would run away. That was why the park suggested backpackers never hike alone. The bear under discussion had been surprised by 2 hikers, charged them, mauled them. "Couldn't be too bad," Joan said. They walked out, then fled up the trail and smack into unfortunate hiker number 3. "Nobody died," Joan pointed out. "If the bear wanted them dead, they'd be dead. If the bear wanted to eat them, they'd be dragged off and eaten, their remains cached in a shallow hole and covered over for later. Ergo, the bear did not want to kill them. Ergo, the bear did not want to eat them. From the look on Rory's face, all he'd heard was, "Kill them and eat them." Since they'd been on the trail, he'd been peering into the woods like a man being stalked. If a bear had been watching or following, there was no doubt in Anna's mind that they'd never know it was there. Because Glacier was blessed with a heavy snowpack in winter and afternoon rains throughout the short summer, it lacked the open cathedral aspect of the woods on the eastern slope of the Sierra, or the southern tip of the Cascades. In Glacier, the forest floor was thick with dead and down trees, never burned, never logged, fallen in places as thick as pickup sticks in the child's game. Fern, huckleberry, bearberry, serviceberry, the shoulder-high, broad-leafed thimbleberry, and a plethora of plants Anna couldn't put a name to, tangled in the cross-hatching of rotting timber. A bear wanting to hide would do so. Following her thoughts into the woods, she realized for the first time what an arduous task it was going to be, fighting through the underbrush off-trail to service and reset the traps. Selfishly, she was glad they were covering the high country. Some of it would be above treeline. A good chunk was encompassed by the burn left from the 1998 fire. The going was bound to be somewhat easier. Lost in thought, she rounded a bend in the trail and nearly walked on the heels of Rory Van Slyke. Next to Never Hike Alone on the ranger's list of safe behavior in bear country was Stay Alert. So far, Anna was 0-for-2. "Here's one," Joan was saying when Anna bumbled into the meeting. "This is one of the air trees we've marked. This yellow diamond is what you'll be looking for." She pointed to a piece of reflective plastic that had been nailed to the tree about as high as the average person could reach with a hammer. "We also number them to be sure we know exactly which samples came from which tree. The numbers are behind the trunk at the bottom. We want to notice these trees, but we don't want to advertise them to every hiker down the pike." "What's the barbed wire for?" Rory asked at the same time Anna noticed segments had been stapled to the bark in an uneven, widespread pattern. "That scratches them a little deeper, is all. Pulls out some of the under fur that's more likely to have a little bit of tissue clinging to it so that we can more easily get a DNA sample." "Doesn't that make them mad?" Rory's concern at an enraged grizzly in the neighborhood was clear on his face. "No," Joan reassured him. "They like it. We didn't know if they would or if they would abandon the wired trees, but they seem to actually prefer them. See the tracks? Worn into the moss from the paws of many bears following the same path from the rubbing tree to the trail were two prints made larger by repeated use." "Cool, huh?" Anna agreed it was cool. Rory asked, "Does pepper spray really work?" "It's the same stuff we use in law enforcement," Anna told him. "It's made from the essence of red-hot peppers. I guess it would work on bears. Unless they've developed a taste for Mexican food. Then I think it would only serve to whet their appetites." Joan shot her a look that was not without humor, but made it clear that tormenting Rory was not an acceptable form of entertainment. "We're not going to get ourselves into a situation where we have to find out," Joan said firmly. "Rory, you're an exception to the rule. Most boys love bears. I actually get fan mail because I am the bear lady at Glacier." Joan's voice was pleasant as ever, but it was clear that in harboring fear of bears, Rory had impugned them, and the researcher's feelings were hurt. "One boy emails me every couple of days. He's drawing a map and has to know where the bears go to eat at any given time." "I like bears," Rory said defensively. "You will," Joan promised. "They would certainly like you," Anna said ominously. To distract the children from their squabbles, Joan made the mistake of introducing Anna to huckleberries. Arm in arm with thimbleberries and bearberries, they grew wild over much of the park. In late summer and fall, when they were at their peak, they were the favored food of bears, both black and grizzly. They consumed them by the ton as they stored up as much sugar and fat as they could for a long winter spent curled in dens at the higher elevations. For the next mile or so, Anna played catch-up, foraging for the delicious dark purple berries, then trotting to catch up, pack slamming down on hip and knee joints that weren't nearly so forgiving as they once had been. Joan couldn't resist a few berries herself, but took her responsibilities to her job more seriously than those to her immortal berry-loving soul. The Van Slyke kid had gone about his berrying with zeal, till Anna gave in to the temptation to muse aloud as to whether bears would find huckleberry breath an irresistible enticement. For that, she earned an exasperated look from Joan Rand and Rory's share of the berries. When they crossed Kip Creek, glittering over stones of vivid red, green, and gold, not the murky brown cottonmouth creeks that prevailed in Anna's new home in the South, interest in berries gave way to interest in breathing. Unbeknownst to him, Rory got some of his own back. He was stronger than he looked, and younger than some of Anna's towels. On the climb, much of it on an exposed southwest-facing mountainside, the sun proved its strength. After a mile, Anna was hurting. Sweat poured into her eyes, lungs pumped and burned. Breath sawed through a mouth dry from hanging open, gasping for air like a landed trout. Periodically, Joan called a rest stop in the shade offered by the occasional towering white pine. For this, Anna could have kissed her feet had she not known that if she did so, she'd never get up again. During these brief respites, Anna swatted deer flies, obsessed with the backs of her thighs, and split her concentration between enjoying the view and hiding her physical weakness from her compatriots. From their ever-higher vantage points, they could see seven mountains. Four along the Continental Divide formed a wall encircling them from west to east. Mountains, not green but blue, were still streaked with snow at the summits, and long mare's tails of water cascaded over the rocky faces in tumbles and falls, tracing through stone and forest for thousands of feet. The canyon they labored so hard to climb out of was no exception. A ribbon of white water, now falls, now rapids, now fishing holes, appeared and disappeared as the mountain's magic act unfolded. Between sweating, faking fitness, and mentally promising Amy, her aerobics teacher back home, that she would attend classes religiously if she survived this hike, Anna was dimly aware they pushed through an array of wildflowers that she should be appreciating. By noon, they reached the top. Sheared off by glacial movement, Flat Top was a peculiarity among its steep-sided neighbors. To the east, the argillite cliffs of Mount Kip in the Lewis Range rose over alpine meadows. 6 miles north, the planed top of Flat Top Mountain dropped away, wrinkling down into the Waterton River Valley and onto Canada. Once on Flat Top, they left the comforts of the trail and struck west through the burn, heading toward Trapper Peak. Between Flat Top and Trapper's imposing flanks was a deep cut, much like the one they'd followed during their ascent, where Continental Creek carved its way down 3,000 feet to McDonald Creek to empty its glacial melt. The first of the hare traps was located in a small avalanche chute above the gorge, a place made as attractive as its grander competition by several springs that ran even in the driest years. The fire of 1998 had burned slowly and exceedingly fine, consuming everything in its path. Blue-black snags clawed at the sky, without shade, without greenery or moisture. The sun weighed as heavily on Anna's back as her pack. With every step, cinders crunched under her boots. Black dust boiled up to stick in the sweat and DEET sprayed on her legs. Despite the insecticide, horseflies, deerflies, and mosquitoes followed. With only a brief window of opportunity in which to slake their thirst, they were fearless. Despite the ash and grit, she blessed the fire that had torched 10,000 acres of America's crown jewel, taxed the glacier superintendent's courage, not to mention the Waterton superintendent's faith in the good sense of the U.S. superintendent as he watched the NPS let burn policy crackle toward the Canadian half of Waterton Glacier International Peace Park. Waterton Glacier was a unique and highly successful experiment. The only park of its kind, one half was in Canada, the other in the United States. with major environmental decisions and park regulations worked out jointly between the two countries. The Canadian superintendent was less optimistic than the American superintendent when it came to letting nature burn where she would, but Glacier's superintendent stood firm. The fire had been left to burn itself out, and Anna was glad. She was no great devotee of trees. They blocked one's view of the forest. And fire cleaned out the deadwood, exposed the soil to light and air, making possible the riot of life that followed fire's necessary cleansing and renewal. Against the scorched earth, with the liquid gold of the lowering sun, a carpet of glacier lilies glowed with an electric green so intense she could remember seeing it only in the altered states of consciousness of the late 60s and the paintings of Andy Warhol. Glacier lilies were fragile yellow blooms, smaller than a half dollar, that hung pointed and curling petals in graceful skirts around red stamens heavy with pollen. Their leaves grew from the base, sharpened green blades as tall as the blooms. Under this glamorous show, according to Joan, they hid bulbs rich in starch. The bulbs were routinely dug by the grizzlies in late summer and early fall as they followed the huckleberries into the higher elevations. At the height of the season, great swatches would be dug up, leaving areas that looked as if they'd been rototilled. This year, the flowers were spectacular. Glacier had gotten nearly twice its normal snowfall. Snows hadn't melted above 6,000 feet until July. Spring, summer, and fall were happening simultaneously, as plants, so lately released from their winter sleep, rushed through the stages of life to reseed before the first cold nights in September. "Hey," Joan said, "we've got company." Anna dragged her eyes up from where they frolicked in fields of green and gold. On a low ridge to the north, black, as everything was black from a fire that had burned hot, fast into the bone, stood a lone hiker. Behind him was a wall of exposed stone, probably once fawn-colored, but now the gray-brown of rotting teeth where the rains had imperfectly washed it free of soot and char. It wasn't against park rules to hike off-trail, or camp off-trail for that matter, though that required a special permit. It was unusual. For a man alone, it was also foolish. Bears were the least of the dangers of hiking by oneself in the backcountry. The greatest were carelessness and stupidity. A slip, a fall, a badly sprained ankle or shattered kneecap, and one could die of exposure or thirst before anybody thought to begin a search. Rory, sensing a social and so static occasion, was quick to drop his pack and dig out his water bottle, a state-of-the-art model with the filter built in. Anna allowed herself a fleeting moment of envy. "Hello," Joan called cheerily, because she was that kind of person. A happy hello from a small middle-aged lady was scarcely the stuff of nightmares, but even at 20 yards, Anna could swear she saw the hiker flinch, cast a glance over his shoulder, as if deciding whether or not to make a run for it. Like a hound that hears the clarion call, fatigue fell away, and Anna's mind grew sharp. "Wonder what in hell he's been up to." She wasn't aware she'd spoken out loud till she noticed Joan and Rory staring at her. "What?" she demanded. Joan just chuckled. Few people chuckled anymore, that low, burbling sound, free of cynicism or judgment that ran under the surface of mirth. Anna's attention went back to the hiker. He was walking toward them. Reluctantly, she thought. This time, she kept her suspicious nature under wraps. At first, she'd resented the heightened awareness that law enforcement duties forced upon her. But somewhere along the line, she'd come to enjoy it, as if looking for trouble was a desirable end in itself. The interloper was in his teens, at a guess, though maybe older. His beard was non-existent, but an accumulation of grime aged him around the mouth. He'd been in the backcountry a while. Hazel eyes, startling under beautifully shaped brown brows, and shaded by a ball cap with a dolphin embroidered above the brim, moved nervously from place to place, as if he looked beyond their tiny band to see if there were reinforcements hiding, waiting to ambush him. The pack he carried was big, too heavy for day hiking, but not packed for overnight. Judging from the way the ripstop nylon bagged inward, it contained neither sleeping bag nor tent. He was camped out somewhere. So why carry the frame pack? And why the haunted look? "You're a ways from anywhere," Joan said, and stuck out her hand. After the briefest pause, he took it. Workman's hands, Anna noted, calloused and scarred, the nails broken and rimed with dirt from too long between baths. Odd for a boy so young. His shirt was streaked with soot, and he wore a chain wrapped twice around his waist. "You all just out camping or what?" he asked. The question didn't seem particularly neighborly to Anna, but didn't bother Joan in the least. She launched into an explanation of the Great Glacier Bear DNA Research Project, the wording geared for the ears of laymen. Anna set her pack down and freed her water from a mesh side pocket. Joan was proselytizing, converting the masses to greater respect of bears. Anna tried to figure out where the boy's accent was from. Henry Higgins aside, few people could place others by their dialect, except within the broadest of areas. Americans made it more difficult by swimming around the melting pot, kindergarten in Milwaukee, third grade in San Diego, high school in St. Louis. The South was as close as Anna could place him, anywhere from Virginia to Texas. Out of long habit, she committed his physical description to memory. He was a big kid, though not tall, around 5'8", chunky without being fat. The kind of body that's a good deal stronger than one would think. Shoulders sloped away from a round, handsome neck. What hair she could see poking from beneath the ball cap was silky brown, with a natural wave. One day soon, his face would be chiseled into classic good looks. Anna could see it in the aquiline nose and the rounded, prominent chin. She took another drink, sat on a rock. The boy never loosed his pack, made none of the comfortable settling-in gestures she and Rory engaged in. When Joan had done with her sales pitch, he asked her where they were going for their traps. Obligingly, Joan began showing him on the topo. Anna found herself wishing she wouldn't. His interest was overly specific, having nothing to do with the project and all to do with where the three of them were going to be at any given time. "I'm Anna Pigeon," she interrupted, none too subtly. "This is Joan Rand, Rory Van Slyke." Stepping up to him, she thrust her hand out, much as Joan had done. No better way to get the feel of somebody literally as well as figuratively. Despite the afternoon's heat, his palm was clammy. He was scared or had serious problems with circulation. A rank odor came off him, not just the accumulation of unwashed body odors, but something muskier, almost an animal smell. "What's your name?" Again, the flinch.
Jeffrey Mickelson.
"Nicholson?" Joan asked helpfully.
"Nicholson."
Now Anna knew he was up to something. "Where are you from, Jeffrey?" Had she been on the trace in uniform, she'd have had this boy out of his car, his driver's license in her hand, quicker than a swallow can change directions in flight.
"Oh, you know, all over. I'd better be going. It's a ways back to camp."
He smiled for the first time, and Anna resisted the temptation to be charmed. Not only was it pretty, his straight white teeth probably the cleanest part of him, but sparked with a hint of apology and an innocence that bordered on goodness. The smile was at odds with the rest of the package. Anna chose to ignore it.
"Be seeing you around," she said, as he turned and walked back the way he'd come. It sounded more like, "We'll be keeping an eye on you."
Anna meant it to. Some people bore watching. She was sure this fellow was among them. She was just as sure they wouldn't be seeing him, not if he saw them first. Burbling notes drew her back into the present. Joan was smiling, her eyes full of altogether too much fun.
"I do declare, in another minute or two, you were going to frisk that boy and read him his rights."
Frisking I could understand,
a smile to make you lie right down and die. Rory found a lump of charred wood to fix his attention on. Evidently uncomfortable with women his mother's age or older having impure thoughts. He was so fishy, I thought he was going to sprout gills and swim away, Anna defended herself. Aw, he was just shy. He was carrying a half-empty frame pack. Maybe he lost his day pack. It was too full for a day hike. Maybe he's a photographer carrying cameras, tripods, film. Maybe, Anna said, but she didn't think so. Why the big interest in where we were going, where we were camping? Because he's a nice young man, and nice young men pretend to be interested in what their elders and betters are saying. Isn't that right, Rory? That's true, Rory said. With such sincerity, Anna wanted to laugh, but didn't for fear of alienating him. See? Proof, Joan said. Anna didn't say anything. She was getting entirely too crabby over the whole thing. Aren't we almost there? She asked plaintively. Chapter 3. By the time they reached the vicinity of the first hair trap, too little light and too little strength remained for anything but setting up camp. With the departure of the sun, the mountain grew cold. The thin, dry air didn't retain heat. Horseflies and deerflies took themselves off to wherever it was they went during the dark hours. But the mosquitoes remained, a cloud of mindless hunger hovering over the camp. Despite their carnivorous attendance, Anna hauled water from a startlingly beautiful creek, a ribbon of green that cut through the burn scar, sparked by a joyous multitude of mountain wildflowers. Staying clean in the backcountry was an arduous undertaking. Results obtained for effort put forth seldom satisfying, but for Anna, it was a necessary if she was to maintain anything close to good cheer. Tonight's ablutions were brief, as every square inch of flesh was assaulted by flying proboscises the moment it was exposed. Too tired for culinary frills or witty conversation, the three of them ate their freeze-dried lasagna, then crawled into their sleeping bags. Rory was restless and noisy in the tent beside theirs. Anna lay next to Joan, scratching insect bites and wondering if all earthly paradises had been infiltrated by something wretched, all ointments incomplete without the requisite fly. Yet she was uniquely happy. From time and use, cloth walls and hard ground had come to symbolize a freedom that loosed her mind and soothed her soul in a way she'd never been able to duplicate between cotton sheets. Sleep curled down, and she went willingly into free fall. The trap they tended in the morning was in as awkward a locale as nature and researchers could devise. Glacier National Park was slashed with avalanche chutes. These cuts were scoured year after year when snow grew unstable in springtime and was carried by its own prodigious weight down these natural passages. Because snow and ice cleared the chutes of larger vegetation, the rocky soil had little to bond it to the steep-sided gorges. When rain followed snow, mudslides followed avalanches. The only plants that could survive these inhospitable conditions were fast-growing, supple, and ever-renewing. From a distance, the chutes appeared as paler green pleats in a mountain green robe, nearly barren, at best knee-deep in ground cover. Up close, they were head-high in a riot of color, red paintbrush, lavender fleabane, hot pink fireweed, white cow parsnip, lacy green false hellebore, the flashy red of choke cherries, white pearls of baneberry, rich purple huckleberries, fierce yellows of butterweed and arnica. Of these, the bears enjoyed all the berries, hellebore and cow parsnip. A veritable salad bar and a perfect place for the trap. The trap itself was marvelously low-tech. 80 feet of barbed wire was strung from tree to tree, or in this case, tree to rock to snag to tree, 50 centimeters above the ground. Inside this ephemeral corral was a litter of rotten pieces of wood, strewn haphazardly about, and a single sapling 20 feet high. "What do you think?" Joan asked. Such was the pride in her voice, Anna dug deep to find something nice to say. "It doesn't stink," she ventured. "That's right," Joan said, as if Anna was a very clever student. The researcher dropped her fanny onto a rock, letting the stone take the weight of her pack as she squeezed free of the shoulder straps. "The smell of the dynamite." "Dynamite? You're kidding," Rory said incredulously. "That's what we call the blood lure," Joan admitted. "A lot more civilized than what I'd call it," Anna contributed. "Be grateful for DNA mite," Joan said. "We've tried runny honey made of blood, fish, and banana, and Blinky's demise with fish blood and fennel oil. My personal favorite, cattle casket picnic in a basket, a succulent mix of blood, cheese essence, and calamus powder. Then there was one with Vicks Vapor Rub, licorice whip with blood, anise, and peppermint." "Dynamite is sounding better all the time," Anna said. "Anyway," Joan went back to the original thought, "the smell goes off in a week or 10 days. The love scent lasts somewhat less." "The skunk in the film canister?" Rory said. He, too, was divesting himself of his pack. Anna followed suit. "That's right," Joan exclaimed. "Two excellent pupils in one day. Only this one was a sweet cherry scent. Every two-week round, we change this lure. Bears are terrifically smart. It only takes them once to learn something. And they teach it to the cubs, usually in one lesson they remember for a lifetime. The bears come for the dynamite, and they have a good roll, but there's no food reward. We didn't want them to get habituated to traps as food sources. So next time, maybe they're not so interested when they smell the blood and the fish. That's why we've got the love scent, a little something new to pique their interest. We started with beaver castor, then fennel oil, smoky bacon, a real winner, then sweet cherry, and now, last round of traps, bears with jaded palates, we bring out the pièce de résistance. Skunk." Free of her pack, Joan stood and shook each of her parts, feet, legs, hands, arms, trunk, like she was doing the hokey pokey. Ritual completed, she turned her attention to the trap. The love scent hung up high to broadcast on the breeze and to keep it out of reach so the first bear doesn't take it down. She paused a moment, then muttered, "Harumph." Anna laughed. She'd never heard anyone say harumph, though she'd read it a time or two when she was working her way through the old dead English authors. "Hung it too low," Joan said. "Heads will roll. Look, it's gone." Anna hadn't coupled Joan Rand with the activity of rolling heads, but watching her face, she had little doubt the threat was not empty. Clearly, incompetence was not tolerated in pure research. Anna made a mental note never to screw up. "Maybe a bear climbed up and got it," Rory offered. He'd felt the chill as well and tried to deflect the anger from the hapless hanger of scent. "Grizzlies don't tend to climb trees," Joan said. "Nor the adults. Cubs can climb some. This little tree is not big enough around to climb. No, if it had been hung properly, a bear couldn't get it. Not unless he had a 15-foot reach." "Where does the hard stuff go?" Anna asked. "The dynamite." Rory snorted. Okay, Joan said. "Let's just call it the lure. Now, that wonderful catnip of bears is poured on a pile of rotting wood in the middle of the trap. Or if the middle is ocupado, as in this case." She waved at a 4-foot-high piece of rock, nearly obscured in the brush that choked the enclosure. "At least 5 feet from the wire. We don't want him getting the goodies without squeezing under the wire first. We save that lure for last. Pour it, then get upwind before it permanently saturates our nose hairs. Take a look at this." Joan poked at a bit of the widely scattered pieces of rotten wood. "He's everywhere. Our bears must have had a regular jamboree." A painting, Teddy Bear's Picnic, came to Anna's mind. A bucolic scene of bears depicted in human poses, picnicking in the woods, indolently pursuing human entertainments. She'd always found the picture disturbing. I was told dead bears, bears that have been skinned, look like people, she heard herself say, and wondered where the comment had sprung from. Joan hesitated before responding. Her usually clear, greenish eyes narrowed and clouded briefly. Anna got the feeling she'd been out of line, but couldn't guess how.
That's so, Joan said. It's unsettling. Not something I'd care to look at more often than I had to.
She glanced at Rory. He'd lost interest in them and washed trail mix down with water. Anna realized what the problem was. Joan suspected her of trying to creep out the Vance-like boy for the sheer evil fun of it. Oh, she said, and closed her mouth to reassure the researcher that her motives were pure. Joan handed out latex gloves, envelopes, and pens from where they were cached in her pack. Anna and Rory were set to work collecting the hair while she took scat samples from the many opportunities with which ecstatic bears had provided her. Approximately every foot along the wire was a barb. Wearing gloves, so as not to contaminate the samples, Anna carefully plucked the fur free of each barb and deposited it in its own small envelope. Rory then sealed it and wrote the date and location of the trap on the back. Using an alcohol-based disinfectant, the metal was then cleaned to remove any remaining tissue or hair cells, and they moved on to the next barb to repeat the process. When they were done collecting, the wire would be rolled up and packed out to be reused at the next trap site. The trap that currently worked had been extremely successful. Nearly every one of the rusted points was tufted with fur. The chore was tedious, the footing uneven. The deer flies hellacious. Still, Anna preferred it to the soulless, air-conditioned patrol car she'd spent her days in for too many months. You're good at this, she said to Rory, because she was feeling generous, and it was true. Despite Mother Nature's considerable aggravations, Rory worked with a quiet diligence Anna found admirable in a boy his age. The patience he exhibited with the fussy and exacting nature of their task was admirable in a person at any age. My dad, Les, he corrected himself, or punished his father, and I used to put together airplane models when I was in grade school, when he used to do stuff. Used to? What's he do now? Anna asked, ready to change the subject if he brought up any touching stories of cripples or lingering illness. No sense getting to know him that well. Rory's coarse blonde hair, not yet as sweaty as Anna's, fell from underneath the brim of his ball cap. He pushed it back, and she noticed how small and fine-boned his hands were. He probably fought against being perceived as delicate or wimpy. There was something in his silences that could be attributed to an attempt at toughness. Les is a low-level number cruncher, he said with an unbecoming sneer. Careful not to lose any, Anna brushed three hairs from a gloved fingertip into the envelope he held pinched open. Low-level number cruncher sounded like a quote. Anna wondered who had called Rory's dad that, and why the boy had embraced the derogatory term. What's your mom do? She asked, hoping for a little more enthusiasm to pass the time. Mom's cool, Rory said, as they crabbed over half a yard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.